accord, join in a song with sweet accord, and thus around the throne, and thus around the throne. We're marching to Zion, beautiful, beautiful Zion. We're marching upward to Zion, the beautiful city of God. The hill of Zion yields a thousand sacred sweets. Before we reach the heavenly fields, before we reach the heavenly fields, or walk the golden streets, or walk the golden streets. We're marching to Zion, beautiful, beautiful Zion. We're marching upward to Zion, the beautiful city of God. Then let our songs abound and every tear be dry. We're marching through Emmanuel's ground. We're marching through Emmanuel's ground. To fairer worlds on high, to fairer worlds on high. We're marching to Zion, beautiful, beautiful Zion. We're marching upward to Zion, the beautiful city of God. All praise to Him who reigns above in majesty supreme, who gave His Son for man to die, that He might man redeem. Blessed be the name, blessed be the name, blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be the name, blessed be the name, blessed be the name of the Lord. His name above all names shall stand, exalted more and more. At God the Father's own right hand, where angel hosts adore. Blessed be the name, blessed be the name, blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be the name, blessed be the name, blessed be the name of the Lord. His name shall be the Counselor, the Mighty Prince of Peace. Of all earth's kingdoms conqueror, whose reign shall never cease. Blessed be the name, blessed be the name, blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be the name, blessed be the name, blessed be the name of the Lord.
Amen. Continuing our song, Down at the Cross.
The cross where my Savior died, down where for cleansing from sin I cried. There to my heart was the blood applied. Glory to His name, glory to His name, glory to His name. There to my heart was the blood applied. Glory to His name. I am so wondrously saved from sin. Jesus so sweetly abides within. There at the cross where He took me in. Glory to His name. Glory. was the blood applied. Glory to his name. Oh, precious fountain that saves from sin, I am so glad I have entered in. There Jesus saves me and keeps me clean. Glory to his name. Glory to his name. Glory to his name. There of my heart was the blood applied. Glory to his name.
Amen. Please be seated. We got you all warmed up now.
Good morning. My name is Rob Love. I'm an elder here at Central Christian, and I've got announcements. Welcome to Central Christian, everyone here in the auditorium and those worshiping online. We're so glad you could be here. We have a pretty full crowd, looks like. But the announcements this week. First, thank you to all who helped with JAMA this past Thursday. We served a total of 37 families. And remember, the item of the month for JAMA is cake mix. So if you pick up an extra box or two and place those in the bin at the side door, we would appreciate it. Tuesday evening, a small group starts back at 6, this coming Tuesday, at Rosalind's house. Please see Rosalind or Bob Gibson, who's not here today. But if you want to join in, see Roz, or contact Roz or Bob. They're going to be studying the Gospel of John. Okay. The mission of the month, this month, is Campus House at ETSU. Remember them in your prayers as they begin to welcome students back at ETSU, and their leader, Michael Zader, is going to retire at the end of this school year, so they'll be in search for a replacement for him. So keep that in your prayers as well. The ministry team of the month is the children's ministry, and this covers nursery to eighth grade. We can always use another teacher or two back there to help, and if you don't feel led to help, please be in prayer for the children's ministry, the teachers and kids that we have here at Central. The Monday night women's Bible study, led by Roz, is that correct? Yeah. They'll start a new study on the verses that mention but God. This starts tomorrow night at 6 here in the fellowship hall. If you didn't make it last week, they're just getting into the study, so you haven't missed much. So come on out if you feel led to or feel curious about those verses and want to learn more about it. This coming Tuesday is our monthly elders meeting. It's at 4:30 here at the building. It's an open meeting. Anyone can attend. So just know the invitation's out there. Remember our 30-day challenge for praying for the child that was on the card that you got. We're 21 days into this, and if you didn't get a prayer card, please pick one up. They're on the table by the front door back there, and you can start your 30-day challenge today. ETSU football. The first home game is September 7th, and the sign-up sheet is back in the foyer. If you can help work these games, please let John know. And if you're new to Central, we work a concession stand at ETSU, and we earn 15% of the revenue that stand brings in. And this has helped pay for several things around the building. And you can work as many of these games as you like. I think there's six this year. There's six home games this year. You can work all of them, one of them, however many of them you want. Next Sunday is the elder election, voting for elders. Bob Roberson, Bob Gibson, and John Livingston are up for re-election. If you're a member of Central Christian, you can vote. And if you're not going to be here in person, you can vote absentee. And if you would like an absentee ballot, please reach out to me and I'll get you a ballot. Those have to be back in by Saturday the 24th if you're voting absentee. Four Oaks, there is a nursing home that we go into twice a month, and there's a sign-up sheet to help with that. We provide communion, Lord's Supper, lead them in songs and a short message. If you would like to help with that, please see Paul or Emily. Two Thursdays a month? Okay. They go two Thursdays a month. And they need some a few people to help with this ministry. So just see Paul or Emily if you feel led to do that. Remember, our prayer of the month this month is for the students and teachers going returning to school of all ages. They've been, the local elementary and secondary schools have been back in for about a week now, at least. Continue to be in prayer for them and for us to have our best year yet. We have balloons up back here in the library, and they're flying on the wall next to the fifth. Is that still back there?
Fifth
through eighth grade classroom. There's balloons up there too. And these are the balloons. These are the ones that we filled out, right? Yeah, we had balloons a few weeks ago, and we still have some, I think, back in the plate back here under the clock. And you can fill it out with some of the things that are making this your best year yet. And we're gonna put those up on the wall, and kind of like we did for Thanksgiving, where we put up Thanksgiving things we were thankful for on turkey feathers, and we put them up around the turkey. But just something to celebrate that. Are there any other announcements that you know of? Okay, let's go to the Lord in prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, thank you for this day, and thank you for allowing us to come worship you. Lord, we ask that you would open our hearts to your message today, and we thank you for all the blessings you give us throughout our lives, Lord. We ask that you would continue to do that, and we love you. We love your Son. We love the sacrifice that he made, and it's in Jesus Christ's name that I pray. Amen.
We're going to continue our worship. This song that we're going to sing now is entitled Christ is Mine Forevermore. It's a contemporary song. I think it came out maybe 4 or 5 years ago. But it talks about the troubles of this world that we all have. Days when you just feel like, what's going on here? You know, this isn't the way I want to live. And then the chorus of each verse talks about all the hope that we have in Christ. We have the keys to the kingdom, basically. So think about these lyrics as we sing this.
Mine are days that God has numbered. I was made to walk with him. Yet I look for worldly treasure and forsake the King of Kings. But hope is hope in my Redeemer. Though I fall, his love is sure. For Christ has paid for every failing. I am his forevermore. Mine are tears in times of sorrow, darkness not yet understood. Through the valley I must travel, where I see no earthly good. But mine is peace that flows from heaven, and the strength in times of need. I know my pain will not be wasted. Christ completes his work in me. Mine are days here as a stranger, pilgrim on a narrow way. One with Christ I will encounter, harm and hatred for his name. But mine is armor for this battle, strong enough to last the war. And he has said he will deliver safely to the golden shore. and monarchies choose Zion City, where beside the King I walk. For there my heart has found its treasure, Christ is mine forevermore. Come rejoice now, O my soul, for his love is my reward. Fear is gone and hope is sure, Christ is mine forevermore. Come rejoice now, O my soul, for his love is my reward. Fear is gone and hope is sure, Christ is mine forevermore. And mine are keys to Zion City, where beside the King I walk. For there my heart has found its treasure, Christ is mine forevermore. Christ is mine forevermore.
Father God, I love that lyric because it is what you guarantee us for all of those who are in Christ Jesus. Come rejoice now, O my soul, Lord, for your love is my reward. Fear is gone and hope is sure. It's a sure thing, folks. Christ is mine forevermore. Thank you, Lord, for this day. In Jesus' name.
Time for children's worship. I'd like to share this morning the fact that I love this church. Now, you guys are pretty neat people. We come and we go, and it seems like sometimes we show up here on Sunday morning, we do our thing, and go home and don't see each other very often. Debbie and I have been here since 2005, except for about 10 months where we took a break. But you're family to us. Even though our daughters are here and our granddaughters are here, the rest of our family lives somewhere else. And I know that for most of you, you're in the same situation. While some few of you have your family here with you, many of you have kids or grandkids or siblings and parents and all kinds of other stuff scattered all over the place. And so God has given us a church family. Amen. Where we have the opportunity to love on each other, to help each other, to be aware that we don't have to go through this world by ourselves. The church is important. Many times we look at the world today and the church doesn't seem to mean much anymore. We're living in a world where it seems like God and spiritual things and church family simply is no longer the thing that drives this nation, if it ever did. There isn't any question for those of us who know our United States history, though, that this nation used to be much more focused on God than it is today. Most of our politicians, many of them, have no care about what God wants. They teach and promote things that are certainly ungodly, many of them do. And we need to be aware as Christians that this world is not our home. Sometimes we talk about how tough it is to be Christians today. We don't have a clue. Now, we're studying Revelation on Wednesday night, and those people really underwent true persecution. They were executed. They were cast out. They had all kinds of problems. And many other nations in the world today have similar situations. We can hear and read about Christians who are killed, Christians who are captured, Christians who are punished for no other reason than they are children of God. So we have the opportunity to come together and worship and devote ourselves to a church family without any fear, really, of anybody hindering us if this is what we want to do. We're going to start a series this morning, really going to talk about the church. We're going to talk about not only God's church, but we're going to talk about Central Christian Church. And I hope by the time we're done with this series that all of us will have a better understanding of what the church's purpose is and why we have a church here and what can God do with us as members of his church. Three reasons I came up with really why we need to do this at this stage of the game. Number one, we have a lot of new people here at Central Christian Church since we last talked about this. And I want to say thank you to those of you who have shown up over the last year or two. You continue to make Central Christian Church a wonderful place to be. Amen. We have, many of us, been here a long time. I'm not the oldest member here. Manjikati's been here longer than I have. Kyle's been here longer than I have. Brad's been here longer than I have. Several others have been here longer than I have. But some of you are fairly new here, some just a few months. My challenge for us older members is to make sure we incorporate the new ones. It is so easy, and some of us who can occasionally remember what high school was like or middle school might have been like, you know, when the new kid moves in, they have a hard time breaking into the cliques. They have a hard time getting to know people because those of us who have been here for a while understand these are our friends. This is our family. These are people we enjoy being around. And it is not always easy to expand that circle of friends. So I want to challenge those of us who have been here for a while as we welcome new people into our church, that we truly welcome them into our church. That we don't just say, nice to have you, and then we go hang out with all of our old friends and all the people we have gotten to know well, and we sort of leave the others hanging out there by themselves. We need to make sure that as a church, we're incorporating each other. Debbie and I welcomed Stephen into our family when he married Valerie. Stephen's a neat guy. We are blessed to have him as a son-in-law. But we had to make an effort, and I don't mean that in a tough way, but we had to draw him into the family, had to make him one of the kids. We had to incorporate him into the events and things that we were doing. Otherwise, he'd have been sticking out there like a sore thumb. Others of you have had the same situation. You've welcomed people into your family as they've joined up one way or another. Some of us are grandparents. Now, that's an easy thing to do, isn't it? It is not difficult to welcome grandchildren into the family. But you've still got to do it. You've still got to make an effort to let them understand they are welcomed and loved just like the people who have been in the family their whole lives and forever and ever. Amen. And I want us to make sure that we are doing that as we welcome new members into our number, that we are reaching out to them, incorporating them, getting them involved in our Bible studies, in our small groups, every opportunity we can, so that we are getting to know each other the way we're supposed to. Make an effort to do that. I used to say, and I haven't said it for a while, take your church directory out. Go down through the list every once in a while and see how well do you know the people whose names are on those lists. And if you run across someone and you think, you know, I don't know that person very well, I'm not sure I can say much about who they are, then those are probably the people you need to make sure you spend a little bit of time getting to know a little bit better, so that we can all be incorporated into this family of God here at Central Christian Church. That's the ideal. That's what God expects us to do. Second reason, and this is going to be over next week, but we're having an election next week to re-elect potentially elders who already are serving. We don't have any new member or new elders on the list, but Bob Gibson, John Livingston, and myself, who've been serving as elders for a while, we stagger our terms, and every 2 years we get reelected. And so you get an opportunity to vote to whether or not we stay on as elders or not. God tells us how elders are supposed to be viewed. And as we have talked about this in the past, let me assure you, while Paul sort of lists these as qualifications for elders, they apply pretty much to every one of us. Elders don't get to be super spiritual people, and all the rest of you get to goof off. That's not the way God designed this. We are all part of God's family. We are all supposed to be the best spiritual people we can be. But God, when he set up his church, designed that as far as the earthly church is concerned, that you need to have spiritual oversight. And so God designed it where some people were the spiritual overseers of the congregation. Doesn't make them any better than anybody else. Doesn't put us up on a pedestal. Doesn't make us more godly in the sense that you're somewhere down there and the elders are somewhere up here. We are all in this thing together. None of us who are elders at Central Christian Church have the attitude that just because we're elders, we're somehow better than you. That somehow you need to look up to us. I got to tell you, people, I don't want you looking up to me. Jesus is who we look up to. He's the guide. He's the model. He's the one we use as the person we look for to guide us in our lives. We who are elders, hopefully, are trying to shape Central Christian Church into the spiritual family that God wants it to be. It is okay to challenge us. It is okay to question us. Some of you grew up in churches like I did. You didn't question. You just did what the preacher said. You did what the leadership said. And if you ever questioned something, you were labeled as a heretic or unfaithful or a troublemaker or some such thing. We don't do that here at Central Christian Church. And I've said before, and I will say over and over again, when I'm preaching up here, if I say something, use a passage in a way that you think is incorrect or doesn't make much sense to you, please say something. Come see me. Come talk to me. Let's study this out. I never want to preach something that's incorrect. And one thing I've learned in my 77 years is I don't totally understand this book. There is stuff in it that I'm still trying to get a handle on. And so if I say something or teach it in a way that you've been taught differently, or you don't understand it that way, let's have a Bible study. Let's talk about it. Let's study together. I've studied with many of you in here and have changed my mind on the way I see Bible verses because I study with you. I appreciate that. I want you doing that. I want us to challenge each other so that we, as a church of God's people, are understanding the Bible the best we can understand it. And we're helping each other grow. Here's what Paul wrote when he talked about an elder. 1 Timothy chapter 3 says, here is a trustworthy saying. Whoever aspires to be an elder desires a good work. Now the elder is to be above reproach, faithful to his wife, temperate, self-controlled, respectful, hospitable, able to teach, not given to drunkenness, not violent but gentle, not quarrelsome, not a lover of money. He must manage his own family well and see that his children obey him, and he must do so in a manner worthy of full respect. If anyone does not know how to manage his own family, how can he take care of God's church? He must not be a recent convert, or he may become conceited and fall under the same judgment as the devil. He must also have a good reputation with outsiders so that he will not fall into disgrace and into the devil's trap. As you listen to those qualifications that Paul gave Timothy on what an elder is supposed to be, other than being the husband of a wife, those qualifications really apply to all of us. We all should aspire to be that kind of person. But as you vote next week, consider the three of us. If we meet these qualifications and you want to, vote yes. If we don't, or you don't want to, it's okay to vote no. We will not kick you out of the church if you vote no. Number one, we won't know how you vote because we don't have your name on the ballots. But we do the best we can here at Central Christian Church to work together, to be a team, to try to make sure we're all headed in the same direction. John gave a sermon several Sundays ago as we went through the Sermon on the Mount where Jesus says, wide is the way, broad is the path that leads to destruction. We do not want to be on that path. Narrow is the gate. Straight is the way that leads to life. That's the one we want to be on. But to get on that path, we need to help each other. We need to work together. We need to encourage each other to be the people God wants us to be so that we are being the church God calls us to be. Third reason I think we need to occasionally talk about what is the church and why is it important to us is we are living in a world today where secularism is pushing the church out. The church is no longer the center of the community the way it used to be. The church is no longer the thing that people look up to. Most of us who are older can remember nobody played sports on Sunday morning. Nobody played sports on Wednesday night because people went to church. And now everybody plays sports on Wednesday night and Sunday morning, and they travel all weekend and they do all kinds of things. Church just keeps getting pushed farther and farther away. The latest poll says 65% of Americans still believe in Christianity and consider themselves Christians. 65%. That's down from 76% about 10 years ago. That's a big drop, real quick. Part of the reason for that is not just that Christians have stopped being Christians, it's that we're drawing people from around this world who are not Christians, right? We have people coming from Muslim countries and Hindu countries and places where different religions are the norm, where we didn't used to have that. Used to have people who came into America, for the most part, still were Christian-oriented people. That is no longer the case. So the population demographic is changing. That's one reason. But another reason is way too many of us who grew up in the church have kids or grandkids who aren't in church. And so the number of church-going people who have been church-going people are losing their children or their grandchildren because they don't go to church. They no longer believe. The Nothing Group, which is a new group, I guess, that Barna includes in his polling things, is growing by leaps and bounds. They don't believe in anything. They don't believe in Jehovah God, they don't believe in the Allah God, they don't believe in a Hindu God, they don't believe in any kind of God, they just don't believe in squat, whatever that is. And so we have a bunch of people in America who no longer have a faith in anything. And so when you talk to them about God, when you talk to them about salvation, when you talk to them about needing to get our lives in tune with some kind of a standard, to them there is no standard. It's whatever I want to do. It's whatever makes me comfortable. And beyond that, it's whatever makes everybody comfortable. So we need to just let everybody do what everybody wants to do and stop telling people what to do. Some of you tried that with your kids. How'd that work out? does not work. We discipline our children with the hope that they learn how to be good adults once they grow up. Very few of us took the Spock idea, which is basically let kids do whatever they want and hope for the best. Some of you are shaking your head because you know that does not work. And it doesn't work in families any more than it works in countries. If we get citizens who have decided the law is meant to be ignored and nobody can tell me what to do and nobody can push me around and everybody needs to just live and let live because we just want to sit around singing Kumbaya or something, this nation is not going to make it. And we've seen examples of that over the past several years as whole groups of people decide the law no longer applies. I still love to keep up on law. Some of you just come here from California or you've lived there before. Governor Newsom just signed a bill. And California is acting like this is God's gift to humanity. This is the new ideal because they're now supporting the law. They just signed a bill that says you no longer have to prove your car was locked in order to convict someone for burglarizing your vehicle. That used to be the law in California, that if somebody broke into your car and took your stuff, you had to prove your car was locked in order to convict those people. They finally, I guess, have realized that makes no sense. And so they just signed a bill that says that doesn't work anymore. You don't have to prove your car was locked. If somebody breaks into your car and steals your stuff, they're crooks. In California, they're advertising this like, wow, look how law conscious we are. Who in their right mind would think that was a good law? I mean, it really makes no sense to me. And then they just passed another law. I think it was the same bill. Including in it is more stringent punishments for these smash and grab groups. You know what those are, right? They get a bunch of people, 5, 10, 12, or whatever, and they just go into a store, smash their way, and grab whatever they can as a mob and run out with it. Well, California, I think, has finally decided that's not a good idea, that we need to try to stop this. So now they've increased the law in California to try to stop that. But in the same argument, they're against repetitive shoplifters being punished more harshly. That doesn't seem fair, they don't think. We live in a world that's losing its mind. And if we're not careful, that permeates into the church. And we get people in our churches who think I can do whatever I want to do. God's word doesn't apply to me. I can pick and choose the parts I want. And it's no wonder people think that way when the world around us thinks that way. And we start thinking that way. I don't like this passage, so I'm just going to ignore it. I don't like that passage, so I'm just going to play like it's not in my Bible. And don't you dare tell me it is, because I don't want to hear it. And you can't tell me what to do. One thing we try at Central Christian Church is to never impose things on people that the Bible doesn't impose on people. Some of you have come from churches where they've got all kinds of rules, all kinds of things that they do and requirements that you have to make and all these kinds of things. And I'm not saying whether that's good or bad. But here at Central, if the Bible doesn't say this is what you need to do, we do our darndest not to try to impose additional rules on you. But one thing we will try to do, we'll teach this book. And we'll teach all of it. And we'll do the best we can to cover it one end to the other. Teaching, here's what God says. It isn't what I say. And that's why if I ever come out with something that sounds like I'm making up stuff or adding stuff to the Bible, I want you to come tell me. I want you to come say, Bob, show me a chapter and verse where it says I have to do this. And if I can't find that, then you don't have to do it. Guess what? I'm not your boss. Seriously, I don't want to be your boss. I really don't want to tell you what to do. I want all of us to try to figure out what the book says and live what the book says. And if we will do that, we will be the church that Christ established. But we are living in a world where church is being pushed out and fewer people go. And that's 65% of people who identify as Christians. The same study said only 23% of that 65% regularly gather with other Christian people. In other words, less than a quarter of the 65% come to church. The others never darken a door. But I'm a Christian. And maybe they became Christians when they were baptized as babies. Maybe that's what they think, that's all it takes. Maybe they went to a Bible camp and got caught up in the hoopla and thought, okay, I'll get baptized at Bible camp. But they never really had a relationship with Jesus. And please don't misunderstand me. I love Christian Bible camps. Go to them. Enjoy them. But we can't allow our relationship with Jesus to hinge upon one weekend of fun stuff. It needs to be deeper than that. We need to learn who Jesus is, and we need to commit to doing the kind of things God wants us to do. Bible camp's a great place to learn about Him. It's a lot of fun with a bunch of kids. But we who are Christians need to realize being a Christian is more than just a weekend adventure. It's a lifestyle. It's what we're supposed to do all the time. That's why as Christians, and especially as members of Central Christian Church, I hope all of us are doing the best we can throughout the week to be a Christian example to people. Story I've told several times, but I still like it. We used to have a preacher who said, if you go act like a jerk out in the community, don't tell them you go into the name of the church we were going to then. Tell them you go to the Baptist church. Tell them you're Methodist. You know, don't say you come here because we don't want you being an example, bad example of that. You know, people can get bad examples anywhere. They don't need Christians giving them bad examples. We need to be the kind of people that when people see us in the community, we're people of our word. We get along with people whether they're in our church or not. We don't flip people off when they cut us off in traffic. You know, that's the old joke of the cop who pulls the car over. It's got a fish on the back. And the cop pulls the person over and the person says, why did you stop me? And he says, well, I saw the way you treated those people that cut you off back there and I noticed the fish and I figured you must have stolen this car. Because that's not the way Christian people should be acting. We need to not have that kind of example. If you're going to profess to be a child of God, live like one. 24/7, the best you can. Now guess what? None of us are perfect, right? None of us are going to do it right all the time. But when you don't, apologize. Say I'm sorry. Go to the person that you yelled and screamed at and say, you know, I'm sorry I did that. I'm a believer in Jesus, and that's not the way I want to act. You will knock their socks off by doing that. Because the world doesn't do that. The world doesn't apologize for what they do. But if you as a person following Jesus, when you do something wrong and people know it, or you mistreat someone, go to those people and say, I apologize for this. I'm a child of God and I don't want to act this way. Will you please forgive me? They might very well say, well, that's the kind of person I want to be around. Someone who recognizes their faults. Someone who doesn't have to make up excuses for when they do something wrong. Just say, I'm sorry, and move on and try not to do it again. But we're supposed to be Christian examples. The Bible says the light of God shines in us so that we can reflect it onto the people we live with. What kind of light are we reflecting as Christian people? So out of the 65% of Americans who claim to be Christians, 23% of them come to worship. That doesn't say much for our country. That is not a big percentage. That puts those of us in a very small minority of Americans who, generally speaking, show up on Sunday morning to worship together. That's why coming here on Sunday is so important. We need to be able to gather with each other, draw encouragement from each other, study and learn together. Let me also say, as I've said before, if the only Bible you're getting is the 20 or 30 or 40 minutes John and I stand up here and preach to you a week, you're not getting enough. You need to be in a Bible study. You need to be doing your own Bible study. You need to have a small group, maybe one or two or three people, that you just come together and talk about God. Doesn't have to be a formal, let's do verse by verse Bible study thing. But if you're trying to get through the week and you don't ever spend any time talking to other Christian people, you're struggling. It just isn't possible. You can't be a two-hour Christian and hope to be the person God wants you to be. So as we gather here on Sunday, I like to view this more as a pep rally, which the kids had Friday night, I guess it was, in Unico. You know, oldest granddaughter's a cheerleader, so we have to go to all these rah-rah things, you know, and watch her do her stuff. Debbie does that a whole lot better than I do. But I sort of view Sunday morning worship like that. We need to come together and get excited and stirred up and encouraged and fed and boosted so that when we leave this building and we're out of here Monday through Saturday, we've got enough energy to keep us moving. And so we need to be recharged through the week. Amen. I don't know about you, but if I only ate lunch on Sunday, I wouldn't have this gut. Maybe I need to... You and I know you can't do that and live well. You can't do it spiritually either. And that's why, as Central Christian, we have a number of small groups. We have a number of Bible studies, new ones starting up, getting started again Tuesday night. We try to make those available to you so that you have the chance to come and learn, number one, what the book says. But guess what? That is not enough. You can memorize the Bible. Somehow you got to learn to implement it into your life, right? Because just learning it isn't going to get you anywhere. The devil quoted scripture to Jesus. Knowing the Bible is not enough. You need to learn, how do you live the Bible? How does it change your life? How does it work so that you are able to be the example we're supposed to be? And I really believe the best way to make that happen is to sit around with other Christian people and talk about experiences. That's what a lot of the small groups do. You have an opportunity to share together and do things together where you're talking about, okay, here's what the Bible says. How would I do that in this circumstance? How would this work if I encountered this? What would I say if this was happening or somebody said this to me? And we can study and role play, for lack of a better word, and learn, how do we respond and react to things in this world where I need to implement God's word into my life? We don't do a lot of that on Sunday morning. For the most part, John or I get up here and we tell you what the Bible says. And again, I think that's good. You need to know what the Bible says. But you really learn how to live the Bible by interacting with people, by allowing others to be able to share with you, here's how I handled this. And one of the neat things about a church family is you may be in a situation that you've never been in before, but I'm willing to gamble, if I gambled much, that there's 5 or 6 or 7 people in our church family who have been through that experience. And they can tell you how they got through it. And that might give you some ideas of how you might better get through it. We need to be listening to each other. We need to be encouraging each other. There's a song, I think it's 2 or 3 years old now probably. And it resonates with me. It's called Older People. And the song talks about how cool it is to be around and learn from older people. Every one of us were young once. Some of you still are. A couple of you. Young ones back over yonder. Older to you is 35 or 40. Right? I mean, let's be honest. When we were in our teens, early 20s, if you were 40 or 45, you were old. And none of us wanted to listen to what you had to say because you were out of touch. You had no clue what it was like to be a kid. Like we somehow missed that part of our life, I guess. But in God's church, we need to get away from that mindset. We need to realize that people who have been Christians a long time have lived through so many experiences and opportunities to use God's word correctly, or maybe even incorrectly, that they can teach you how to handle things as they come up. We need to learn from each other. That's why Paul says older women need to teach younger women. Older men need to teach younger men. We all need to be helping each other grow so that you don't have to try it all by yourself. I mean, isn't it neat when you're trying to do something to have somebody who knows how to do it right there with you, going along beside you? It's a whole lot easier. And we know that works in the world. It works in God's church, too. So as Christians here at Central Christian Church, the goal is let's help each other. Let's be a helpmeet to one another. Let's work together to be the church God wants us to be. We need here at Central Christian Church and in this country a better way to look at God's church. I don't know how you view God's church. I would suspect if I started here with Josh and went all the way back there to Rob and had you write down, how do you view God's church? We would have all kinds of answers, all kinds of ideas, which may or may not be okay. But sometimes I think we misview how God's church is supposed to be. And some of us think, as long as I'm here on Sunday, I'm home free. Now I'm hoping that number's getting fewer and fewer and fewer. I'm hoping here at Central we're learning you don't get to act like a Christian on Sunday morning and live like whatever you want to Monday through Saturday. I'm hoping we're trying to grasp the idea that if we are members of God's church, we're always members of God's church. Not just on Sunday, not just on Wednesday, not just on Tuesday, not just on Thursday, not just when you're in a Bible study. You're always in God's church. And he expects us to live correctly no matter what. We're not going to finish this sermon today. Let me tell you this. Jesus uses the word church twice in the Gospels. And you might think, well, if that's true, it must not be very important. Well, it is important. It's important because Jesus purchased the church with his blood. There is nothing on this earth more important to Jesus than his church. As we work through this series, we'll find that one of the primary words used to define the church in the Bible is it's the bride of Christ. Do you think God cares about the bride of his son? You think Jesus cares about his bride? Yeah, I think so. I think Jesus views us collectively, his bride, as something special, as something vital, as something important. So important that he gave his life to redeem it. Those of us who are in his church owe Jesus everything. Because without him, we'd be lost. Without him, we would have no hope. Without him, we would be coping in this world, hoping to figure out what's going on, but the end result would be nothing. So when we think about God's church, I want to encourage us, put some value on this church. View it as something precious. If we will do that, it'll change the way we see each other. Because every one of us who are in God's church, collectively, but also Central Christian Church, belong to each other. I'm not the perfect husband. Debbie can give a list of all kinds of things I don't do well. But I love her. And I want to stay with her. And you do something to hurt her, the answer to me. Now put yourself in Jesus' place. He's got a bride that he loves and died for. You do something to hurt his bride, you enter him. Don't downplay the value of God's church. Don't view Central Christian, which is our church home here, as just something you can take it or leave it. You can come or go. It's important today, but tomorrow I really couldn't care less. I got a million things to do, and if I have time for church, I'll, you know, watch it online. This church is valuable to Jesus. It's precious. Don't minimize its importance. And I know, because I've been in church essentially my whole life. I got a break for 4 years while I was in the Air Force. Wasted 4 years in the Air Force. When it came to growing spiritually. I understand taking a break. I understand thinking church is nice, but I can take it or leave it. If we understand how important it is to Jesus, there is no taking it or leaving it. It's this is important to him, so it's important to me. And as we deal with each other, the biggest problem in the church, and we'll talk about this some more next week, is it's made up of people. You know, we preachers like to say, this would be an awesome job were it not for the people in the pews. Seriously, I mean, if all I had to do is get up here and preach and nobody griped and nobody complained and nobody had problems and you paid me, how cool would that be? But it is made up of people. We do not always get along. Does that surprise anybody? We don't always get along. And the sad thing is, we get hurt by people in church. And that hurts even more. You expect jerks in the world to treat you poorly. Take advantage of you. Give you a scam call trying to take your money. I mean, that's what we expect people who don't know Jesus to do. It hurts a lot. When someone you thought you could trust. When someone you thought was a brother or sister in Christ. When they treat you poorly, it hurts much more. But we have a God who forgives everything you can imagine. And because he forgives me from all the dumb, stupid things I've done in my life, there is no room in my life for me not to forgive you. I don't care what you've done. I don't care what you said. I don't care if you go home every Sunday and complain and gripe about, boy, that Bob can't preach. He's getting so old, he needs to retire. We need to learn to forgive each other and help each other and draw closer together. We need to believe that we're all on the same side. Boy, that's hard sometimes, isn't it? We sometimes think the people we go to church with are my worst enemies. And every one of us have been in churches where that's happened. And we've watched churches split down the middle because one group or another group got mad at each other and took half of them away. God help us. It happened here at Central Christian Church some 30, 40, I guess 50 years ago, 1970. That's why Westside is on the other end of town. They used to be a part of Central Christian Church. Something happened. I wasn't here. I don't know for sure what it was, but a bunch of them decided we're going to go start our own church. And for the longest time in Jonesboro, and even now, every once in a while, when I'm talking to people in town, they will say, oh, you're that church that couldn't get along with each other and split. That they built that other building at the other end of town. The community knows. The only reason Westside's over there is because a bunch of people at Central couldn't get along with each other. And I'm not putting down the Westside people today. Very few of them were here then either. But that's not the reputation I want. That's not the way I want the world, and especially our community, viewing us. Oh, you're that church that split. That's not a good example. That's not a way for the world to know who Christians are. You know, Jesus said, be one, and the world will know you are Christians by the love you have for one another. That being true, we have to ask ourselves, when we do things like that, when we can't forgive each other, when one of us leaves in a huff because something ugly happened and I can't stand it and I won't be in the same room as you, we really need to ask ourselves, am I really a Christian? Because it's clear to me that those 65% of people in America who claim to be Christians, I'm not God, so I don't make that call. But I've got a sneaky suspicion. A huge bulk of them are not Christians. You can call yourself whatever you want to. You can claim to believe in whatever you want to believe in. Jesus says, if you love me, you'll keep my commandments. You'll do what I tell you to do. That's the test for us. Do I really love Jesus? Look at your life and ask yourself, am I doing what God wants me to do? And part of that he wants us to do is forgive people. To be able to put your arms around somebody that hurt you and say, I forgive you. You're my brother, my sister in Christ. If the church is important to us, the way it is to Jesus, we forgive people because he forgives us. Let's pray. God, we come this morning and we do realize that we are not perfect people. That we do things we shouldn't do, and we don't do the things we should do, and we act anything but godly sometimes. So God, my prayer for all of us, beginning with me, is that I will be the kind of example you want me to be. That I will be able to look around this church building and my life and my family and love them the way you want me to love them. That we will love each other. That we'll be a church family the way you want us to be that church family. So God, I pray that each one of us, whether we're here in this building or we're watching online or we're watching later, will commit to making Central Christian Church an entity that we respect and love and want to see grow. And that as we're doing that, Father, that we will incorporate people as they join us, and we will truly be simply a bigger and bigger family of your people. Thank you for sending people to us. Thank you for those who have just seen our building or for whatever reason came to visit and are still here. Thank you for those who have been here for a long, long time. And God help us, I pray, to reflect your light in our lives. In Jesus' name, amen. We always offer an invitation on Sunday morning. Rob's up here. Maybe something you'd like us to pray for. Maybe something going on in your life that you think, I just need my church family to pray for me. I need help with something. Maybe you've got a praise. Kyle, it's good to see you. Kyle got over COVID. He's here with us today. He's healthy and well. COVID's still here. People are still getting it. Stephanie Hurt is just getting over COVID as well. So be in prayer that God protects us and our health and the members who are part of our church, that we're able to withstand those kinds of things. Maybe you've got another praise, something good going on in your life that you just want to shout it from the rooftop. Well, you don't have to do that. You can come up here in front of the row and Rob will tell us all what it is. You're a great bunch of people. I am honored to be a part of Central Christian Church. And I hope you are too. And I hope we'll all commit to making this the church God wants it to be. Something else you want to share or pray about, Rob will take your requests and your comments. Let's stand and sing.
Asking prayer for Casey. Had a rough weekend with pain. not be able to sleep. She's also asking prayers for Alyssa as she migrates through her pregnancy and some financial situations she'll be facing with that. And Donnie Hurt wants to praise God for his church family. Thank everyone who's called, texted, or brought food for him and Stephanie as he recovered from his back surgery and she recovered from COVID. And wants to thank God for Stephanie and wish her a happy birthday, which is today.
Okay, is that it? All right. Well, let's go to the Lord in prayer. Heavenly Father, we thank you for this day, and we thank you for just the many blessings you give us. Lord, we pray that you would help us to be a stronger family in you, and as that's what you want for the church, to be a family and to be one under Jesus. Lord, we lift up the campus house, and you know what they're facing there with replacing Mike. Lord, I pray that you're preparing his replacement and that you would make that person known to them. Lord, I pray for our students and teachers returning to school. I pray that you would give them a great school year and that they would have their best school year yet. Lord, I would also lift up our children's ministry, and I pray that you would bless us with more kids and bless us with more people willing to teach and volunteer with them. Lord, I lift up Dennis. He's still recovering from his surgery and is just experiencing setbacks. Lord, I pray for solutions to that, to the pain and the hematoma, and I just pray for healing for him, and that the pain that he's experienced for these many years would be relieved so that he can enjoy life once again. Lord, I pray for, I lift up Mary Lou as well, who's caring for him. And Lord, I can tell she's stretched and worn out dealing with all this. Lord, I pray that you would refresh her and give her strength to be able to continue giving care for Dennis. Lord, I lift up Donnie Hurt and his recovery from back surgery. I pray that you would help him to heal quickly and that he would be relieved from the pain he was experiencing. And Lord, he lifts up praises to you for the church family that he has here with us, for all those who have prayed for him and have brought meals and just been reached out to him. Lord, he thanks you for people willing to do that, Lord. And he thanks you for his wife, Stephanie, who's been taking care of him and caring for him through this. And Lord, she's recovering from COVID, and I pray that the worst of that's over and that she will quickly return to good health. And also wish her a happy birthday, Lord. This is her birthday. Lord, I lift up Margaret and Melissa and Amy. Lord, we pray that you would wrap your arms around them, comfort them. Lord, we have hope of the blessed assurance that you give us through Jesus, that we know that Don is singing praises to you and to Jesus, and that because he believed in you, that he is with you. Lord, as we study in Revelation, you know, if we're on your side, we win. And Lord, we thank you for that assurance. Lord, Mo lifts up Rusty, who's recovering from an attack by his brothers and sisters. And Lord, we pray that his healing will continue. And Mo lifts up praises for all the prayers that this church family's offered up for Rusty, Lord. She really appreciates that. Lord, Marlene has praise that her grandsons are here and that they were able to visit for a time, and she prays for safe travels as they return home tomorrow. And Lord, just praise for Ray to have the strength, the courage, and to know what to say as he is delivering a eulogy at a funeral coming up soon, Lord. We just lift him up to you. Lord, Donnie praises you. His A1C is down to 6.2. He's really excited about that. And he's also asking for travel mercies for next week as he and Rhonda are going to visit her brother. And Lord, Roz is thankful for all the prayers that this family has lifted up for her daughter and her pregnancy, but she's still struggling with her pregnancy, and Lord, she asked for prayers for Roxanne and that. Lord, Susan lifts up Bob for upcoming procedure tomorrow. She prays that it goes well and reveals anything that may need to be revealed. And she's asking for prayers for Rebecca and Chloe as they go through, and Cedric, as they go through this divorce and the upheaval in their lives that this is bringing. Lord, Stephanie comes forward with prayers for a student named Braden Arnold. You know who he is. He's in the fourth grade, and he's been diagnosed with cancer. Lord, I'll just lift him up to you. I'll lift up his family. Give them peace and comfort, and place your healing hand on Braden, that the cancer would be removed from his body. Lord, Brenda is facing some surgeries coming up, and she is faithful, and she praises you for the blessings that she's received through her life. But she's asking for a miracle for these surgeries, that they will help her recover and that she'd be able to walk again, Lord. I lift her up to you, and just wrap your arms around her, Lord. Julie is asking for praises, for prayers for Casey, who's had trouble sleeping from the pain from his hip surgery, and I just ask that you would help relieve that and allow him to get the necessary sleep that he needs. And Lord, she also asked for prayers for Alyssa, her daughter, who's in a pregnancy that's having some complications, Lord, and there's also going to be some financial consequences following this, Lord, and she just lifts Alyssa up and she asks for prayers and blessings for her. Lord, we thank you for this church family that we have. Lord, we ask you to help make us closer and become people we can lean on when we have troubles and struggles. And Lord, help us keep our ears open for people who are going through things that maybe we've gone through, and that we could help with a little advice or just talking to them, Lord. I ask for all these things, and I ask them in your Son's name, Jesus Christ. Amen.
Good morning, church. As we come to study communion today, I just want to ask to prepare your hearts as we listen and think as we prepare to take the Lord's Supper. The Old Testament records an incident when a garrison of Philistine soldiers was positioned at Bethlehem, which was David's hometown. At one point, David expressed a longing for some water from the well that was near the gate of Bethlehem. Three of his mighty warriors courageously broke through the Philistine lines and drew the water from that well and carried it back to David. But David would not drink it. Instead, he poured it out before the Lord, 2 Samuel 23:16. He saw that in that container of water, the blood of the men who went to risk their lives, in verse 17. David believed that he was demeaning their sacrifice by gaining momentary pleasure from an action that had some of that had cost some of his best fighting men their lives. When we take this communion, we have before us symbols of a sacrifice. We see more than a piece of bread. We see Jesus crucified, the one who bore our sins in his body. We see more than juice in a cup. We see Jesus' blood, poured out for many for the forgiveness of sins, words spoken by Jesus when he instituted communion with his disciples. We see grace poured out in abundance, along with his Holy Spirit poured out on us generously. We see someone who broke through the enemy's, Satan's, stronghold and tied up the strong man, so that those he held captive could be set free. We see ourselves as no longer in bondage of sin. But we do not demean Jesus' sacrifice by eating or drinking the symbols of communion. We honor him as he commanded us to do, in remembrance of me. When we then pour out our lives in service as a living sacrifice, as Paul describes in Romans 12:1, Paul himself spoke of his life as a drink offering poured out before the Lord in Philippians 2:17, and then used that same language as he neared a martyr's death, through which he would pass from life to eternity in 2 Timothy 4:6. Not everyone will pour out his or her life to the degree Paul did, but Jesus assures us that even the cup of cold water given in his name will be rewarded in Matthew 10:42. What has been poured into our lives is meant to overflow into the lives of others. And if you'll bow your heads with me, we'll pray, and then we will come. If you haven't done communion with us, we take it together. You'll come up. We'll all stand up. You'll go through the middle row, and you'll pick out a cup of bread and a cup of juice. We have them together in double cups. And then you'll go back to your seat, and then we will take the Lord's Supper together. So, God, thank you for this day. I ask you to just bless and pour your love and mercy on us. God, prepare our hearts as we prepare communion to remember Jesus' sacrifice, God. God, I ask you to just soften our hearts, give us eyes to hear, or eyes to see and ears to hear, and to bless us and just pour into us, Father, as we take this communion. And may we remember Jesus' sacrifice for our sins. Just bless us and pour into us, God, so that we can pour out into the community. In your most precious and holy name, amen. And if you all get up.
Okay. I'd rather have Jesus than silver or gold. I'd rather be his than have riches untold. I'd rather
in Luke 22:19, Jesus says, "And he took the bread, and he gave thanks, and broke it, and gave it to them, saying, 'This is my body, given for you. Do this in remembrance of me.'" In the same way, after the supper, he took the cup, saying, "This is the cup of the new covenant in my blood. which is poured out for you.
Thank you for being here with us today. Marley, Mary Lou, you want to say something or do you just stretch it?
I want to say something.
Okay.
I appreciate everybody and everything that they have done. This is the only time of my life and all prayers, but I would like to add to the prayers two things. We're having medication issues for dentists and my children. God love them. Because without them, I couldn't go to church, I couldn't make a sentence. They're amazing. Thank you.
Thank you. She loves her kids. Thankful for them. You know, and all of us, whether you have kids or you don't, we all have people around us that we can be thankful for. People who have helped us, people who encourage us, people who lift us up, people who see us through the dark stuff. You know, the Bible says, weep with those who weep. And we do a good job with that, I think. But he also says, rejoice with those who rejoice. We probably don't do that as well. We don't always like to toot our own horns. It's okay to share something good and let us rejoice with you. Because that just makes all of us feel better. Our tithing box is on that little table at the end of this center aisle. Thank you for that. We appreciate your financial support. I do appreciate you people. You're good people. God loves you, and I'm doing the best I can. Now, I do love you as well. I appreciate all that you do, to every one of you that's here. Those of you who are fairly new to us, we're glad you're coming. We're glad you're here. We hope you keep coming. We hope you just become part of our family. And we all just grow closer and closer together. Let's pray and then we'll have a final song. God, we are thankful for our church family. We're thankful that your plan was to die for a church so that we could come together and be united and work together and be a representative group of people for your kingdom here in Jonesboro. God, thank you for each one that's here. Thank you for all that each one does. Thank you, God, for the encouragement. Just their presence means. God, I pray that as we leave this building, that we would look for ways to stay in contact throughout the week. And that we would encourage one another regularly, so that we can be the people you call us to be. Help us to reach out to those who don't know you and be able to share with them this great church family that we have and make that part of the attraction. But it is all about you. So God, help us to share your love with people we come in contact with. We praise you in Jesus' name. Amen. Shelley?
Okay, we're not going to sing that closing song, John. It is Stephanie Hurt's birthday today, and she's home with COVID, but I know that she's listening and watching online. So if you could all, for our closing song, we're going to sing happy birthday to her. If you could all just kind of turn your bodies around and look toward the camera. Here we go.